So there are lots of other services as well, not just the IAS, IFS and the IPS. There are services that are immediately subordinate to these. I'm sure Shashi must have explained it to you, or he will be explaining it to you. Which is the largest democracy in the world?
India.
And what else do you know about India? One or two sentences. It is the second largest English speaking of the seventh largest country in India by size, second most populous country. Yes, it is famous for its unity in diversity.
It houses all seven major religions of the world.
Yeah, seven major religions of the world. So you know a lot of things about India, but you should also know that India is a fast growing economy. It's developing very fast. That's very important. Pardon?
It's the fastest growing economy.
It is the fastest, one of the fastest growing economies of the world. And government have initiated a large number of projects and programs for putting our country into fast track. One of them is, just to cite a few of them, one is called Sagarmala. Many of you must have heard about it. It is basically developing the ports of India, strengthening the ports of India, starting new ports of India, trying to bring about interconnectivity among these ports, then developing special employment zones in the coastal region. Another one that the government is focusing on is the Bharatmala project. Bharatmala project is basically trying to connect 550 major district headquarters to far-flung areas of the country, like the remote tribal areas, forest areas, etc. Then you also have Udaan RCS project, which basically is meant to make flying affordable to ordinary citizens. You know, to get into an aircraft, a poor man can't get into it because the flight charges are really high. Many people can't afford it. So the government's program is to make it very affordable. And one of the most important projects is Digital India. That you must have heard about it. That is trying to bring the services of the government to the ordinary citizens electronically. And that is basically by empowering the internet connections in India, even in very far-flung areas, as well as strengthening the country electronically. So why is it, all of you gave you different ideas about why you want to join IAS. Let me give you my own reason why I joined the IAS. This was long time back when India had battled against the Chinese government. India and China had a war way back in 1967. At that time, I was a student in St. Joseph's Convent. The district collector had come to our school and he made a very rousing speech. After the speech, many of the girls took away their gold bangles, their gold earrings, their gold chain and gave it to the district collector, to the collector's fund, war fund. Then I thought, of course, I didn't have any gold ornaments to give it to the collector, but then I thought, this is a very good idea. One day I too will become a district collector and get gold for the country. At that time, I did not know that the job of a collector is not to take gold ornaments. It's something far beyond that, much, much more complex than that. But then at that small young age, when I was in grade 6, I think, since I saw a lot of my senior classmates giving their contributing or donating their gold ornaments to the country, to the collector's fund, I thought that one day I too will become a district collector and get gold for the country. So I came back home, I told my parents that the district collector had come today to our school and he made a very good speech which persuaded many of the classmates to give the gold ornaments to the country. So I too will one day become a collector. So my parents encouraged me to become what I wanted to. Now, coming or joining the civil services, the first thing is that civil service is a position, or civil service is a service that bestows a great amount of authority on you. Even to this day, if you come to India, I don't know how many of you have not come to India, those of you who have come to India and those of you who are familiar with the government knows that if you go to the sub-collector's office or if you see the sub-collector's vehicle going, have you seen a sub-collector's or a collector's vehicle going? How does it go? How? How does it go?
With protection.
What protection does it go? Where does the police sit? In Kerala, yes, in front of the car there will be a police, there will be a police driver, and then you have the red light that twirls and twirls, and a flag. I mean, you're free not to use them, but many of the IAS officers use it. And when the district collector goes, everybody goes away at a very respectful distance. And when the sub-collector also is such a very powerful job, I'm reminded of one of the incidents that happened when I was doing my research. After joining the IAS and after I became the head of department, I took a few years leave to go to the United States of India and to study, to do further studies. At that time, when I was doing my PhD, part of the PhD is to do field work. I mean, I chose a subject that made me do field work. So part of the field work was in India. And that 1 year I did field work in India, 6 months I spent in a place called Alleppey. And from there I used to go to a slum area. And the other 6 months I went to a tribal area in Attapadi. Have you heard of Attapadi?
Yes.
It's a very remote tribal area. I went to Attapadi and stayed with the tribes in one of their huts. So my housemates or my roommates were two girls. One of the girls was a sweeper in the police station in the locality. The other girl was an Anganwadi teacher. Have you heard of Anganwadi?
Yes.
What is an Anganwadi?
Yes.
What? It's a priest, it's a center where services are comprehensive integrated services are offered for children, for pregnant women, for lactating mothers, and for adolescent girls. You have growth monitoring, you have supplementary feed, you have preschool education, you have counseling sometimes. So all these programs are, it's a child care center basically, but mother and child care center. So she was a teacher in the Anganwadi there. So during the course of my stay there, I used to tell her stories about being the head of the department of departments and what are the challenges, because they keep asking me after dinner, we sit together and we speak. So for 3 months, 4 months, I told them, you know, incidents that happened when I was the government secretary. But one day, accidentally, I told her, when I was the district collector, Pathanamthitta, then suddenly both of them got up and said, ma'am, you were the district collector? You should realize that a secretary's job, a government secretary's job, is much higher than a district collector's job. But to the ordinary person, a collector is the most important position or most important designation. So when I spoke for 3 or 4 months, when I had dialogues with them every night about the incidents, about the happenings that had happened in the secretariat when I was holding the post of secretary, it did not impress them much, which was a much senior position than a district collector's post. But when I told them about an incident that took place when I was district collector Pathanamthitta, they suddenly sprang up from their seat and suddenly started showing a lot of respect towards me, because I was the district collector, although the district collector's post is much junior to that of a government secretary. So what I am trying to say is, even to this day, the district collector or the sub-collector is held in such high esteem by the ordinary citizen. Why is it? Because a lot of authority is invested in the position or in the designation of a district collector. The district collector becomes the representative of the government in the district. He or she is a representative of not just one department, he or she is a representative of all departments in the district. That is why once when there was a strike, there was a Hartal, or Bandh, it was a Hartal that was organized by a group of people, SNDP. Then I happened to be traveling from Coimbatore to Kerala. Suddenly they saw this board, district collector. I become the embodiment of government. And what they did is, it was a very violent incident. They burned my car. Because if they burn the car of a district collector, it catches media attention. Mr. Jittas must be knowing that. It catches media attention much better than if you were to burn the car of an ordinary citizen. So my point is, the district collector is the embodiment of all departments. The district collector, he or she, is the personification of the government in the field to the ordinary citizen. And it is a designation or it is a post that is held in high reverence even to this day. So when you become a collector, how many of you will become collector? Can you put your hands up? Why only four hands? What happened to the other hands? Six? Seven? Oh, okay, okay. So one person excluded because he wants to join the IFS. What about the other hands?
IPS.
IPS. So what about the other hands? Oh, now all of you want to join the IFS. Okay. Anyway, so when you become the collector or when you become a diplomat, that is what you finally will become, the ambassador. Or when you become the IPS officer, you will become the DGP, Director General of Police in the headquarters. Or maybe you will be chosen by Government of India to head RAW, Research and Analysis Wing. Or you might head another police force. So whatever it be, you are held in very high esteem by the people. Why? Because you have a lot of authority. And what will you do with the authority? Serve the people. Yes, that is the most important thing. Because there are thousands and thousands of people who are extremely poor in this country. There are very, very vulnerable groups in our country. There are people who are marginalized, who don't even have the capacity to come to a government office because they don't have the money. If they don't go for work, they will not be able to feed their children that day. So there are extremely poor people in India who cannot afford to lose their daily wage and come to the collector's office. So there are so many people who are marginalized, who are in the periphery of society. For those people, you will be a center of great hope. I know so many cases. I don't want to speak about a single incident, but when I was holding the post of district collector, many people used to come to my office, especially women. Because I was a woman, many women have told me that they are able to relate to a woman district collector much better than a male district collector. And you just had to ring up the concerned village office or the police station and the problem will be sorted out. The problem will be solved because a person with the great authority is ringing up. So the lower level officers, for instance, a woman does not get widow pension. You know what a pension is? It's government. It's an amount that government gives for extremely people in extremely difficult circumstances to tide over that situation. So to get a pension, a widow pension, or old age pension, or a disability pension, or even take the case of a property dispute between two people. One person is extremely powerful and rich, the other person is extremely poor. So when there is a fight between both of them regarding the boundary of a property, sometimes the police may take the side of a rich person because they may get bribed. Sometimes they may take action which is not just. So in that case, when a district collector rings up, the police officer or the village officer attaches a lot of importance to what the district collector is saying. So your problem gets solved. So number one, you have lots of authority. With that authority, you can solve the problem of poor people. You can be the voice of the voiceless. There are people who don't even have the voice because they feel that I'm not heard because I don't have money, I don't have position, I don't have power. So you become the representative or you become the mouthpiece of the person who doesn't have money, who doesn't have power. Okay, so it gives you tremendous authority. Number two, so the first is you have lots of authority. Second, what is the benefit of joining the civil service? Can you tell me? Pardon?
Dignity?
Yes, you get a lot of power, you get a lot of dignity. That all goes as one category. Anything else?
All the benefit of India.
All the benefit of India? Yes, that is, that's what I told. It's interlinked to the first point, namely that you get a lot of authority with which you can serve a lot of poor people. Anything else? Why you want to join? Pardon?
Job satisfaction,
yes, it is one of the best services that the government can offer the youth. But there are people who may argue, Mr. Williams, for instance, may say that in the job that I am doing, I am getting a lot of job satisfaction. Mr. Juttas might say that in the job that I am doing right now, he is getting a lot of job satisfaction. So that is one point, all right, but there's another point also. Why is it? What is it that makes? See, for instance, Mr. Williams, he is in the natural gas sector, right? Supposing he joined as a junior engineer in his company. After that, he will get promotion. He will become what?
Senior
engineer. Then he will become what after the promotion?
CEO.
Yes, he will go through different ladders of hierarchy and finally he become the chief engineer. So what happens, he will be able to amass a lot of knowledge about that sector, right? But will he know in great depth about what is happening in the agriculture sector of Qatar?
No.
Will he know what is happening about the education sector? He will know from what he is reading in the newspaper. But if you join IAS, that is a job that will permit you to work in a wide variety of jobs. Today you will be posted as the sub-collector, then the collector, then the director of fisheries, then the director of public instruction, then the director of survey, then you will become the secretary to housing, government to housing department. Then another, after 2 or 3 years, you will become the secretary to government in the revenue department. So the wide variety of job that you do, you will never get it in any other sector. Will you get it in a private sector?
No.
You will master that sector. But the wide variety of job, the nature of the job that you do, so you get to learn a lot of sectors, understand the challenges there and find solutions for yourself in these problems. Then there's another third reason why many people say that we'd like to join the civil services. Can you think of any other reason?
The government will give you money until you die.
Government will give you money and you?
Until you die.
You mean pension? Yeah, that comes with the monetary benefits. Yeah, that's one thing. It is a pensionable job. I don't know about Mr. Williams' job. Does it give you a pension? It doesn't, Mr. Jutta's? No, it doesn't give. So private sector doesn't give pension. What she said is a valid point. In the government, so that even if you are, say, a high school teacher in a government school, you will get pension. That goes with all the power and the authority and the monetary benefits that you get. There's one important reason why I would urge you to join the civil service, and that is you will become part of the policy formulation of the country. Now, which direction should your country go? Should the country take a capitalist course of development, giving a lot of importance to the corporate sector, or should you take a socialist route, that is, helping the poorest of the poor? That policy, you know, the direction of the policy is framed basically, of course, by the minister, but the senior IAS officers have a major role in influencing that. The ministers discuss with the IAS officers, and the IAS officers will tell them, sir, if you do this, it will help a lot of people, it will help millions of people, so let us plan our policy in such a way that it benefits these categories of people. So you can influence the policy and even the plan of a country if you join the IAS. And then finally, you become part of a huge fraternity. In the IAS, if you're posted in Kerala, you'll have your batchmates in Andhra Pradesh, in Telangana, in Jammu Kashmir, in Maharashtra, Punjab, name it. In every state, you will have your batchmates. And you belong to a big brotherhood or a sisterhood. And then if you have a problem in Kerala, you can ring up your counterpart there in the other states and tell them. So it's, for instance, take, what example? Shall we say something to do with the home department, something to do with the security of a state. You want to know the list of people who are very active, who are creating problems in another state. You just have to ring up the home secretary and the home secretary will send you the list if you are your batchmate. Even if he or she is not your batchmate, you ring him up, things become easier because you belong to the same fraternity. Okay. Now, you're all studying very hard to become IAS officers or IPS officers or IFS officers. Now, there are certain qualities for a student who aims high to achieve something. What are the qualities of a student?
Hardworking.
Yes.
Determination.
Courage. Yes.
Sincere.
Sincere to what?
To your
job. No, you haven't become a job seeker as yet. You're still studying as a student.
Sincere
to your studies, to your ambition, yes.
Knowledge about your nation and the world.
Knowledge about your nation, about, and that is if you want to join the IAS. But what if you want to become a drawing teacher? Do you want to, is it compulsory that you should have a knowledge about the country?
No, but it's compulsory that you have knowledge about everything.
That was very useful for me. That's why I said when I use Malayalam words, I'll translate it for you, for both of you. There are a few, characteristics of a student, or rather things that the student should do. One is Prathasnanam. Can anybody guess what the meaning is?
Morning
Not morning prayer, Pratha Snanam. What is get up early in the morning and have a bath so that it makes you fresh. Then Kaga Drishti. What is Kaga Drishti? Planning your future? No, the what is the literal meaning of Kaga Drishti? Drishti is vision, agreed. What is Kaga? Kaga is not future. Kaka, it is actually. Crow. What is so special about a crow's vision? It is very sharp. Yes, very sharp vision. Shwana Nidra. What is Shwana Nidra? Nidra is sleep. Everybody knows that. Okay, you all enjoy it, isn't it? Good sleep. What is Shwana? Shwanan. Dog. Shwanan is dog. So does the dog sleep, have good sleep? It is a very light sleeper. The moment somebody walks into your compound, the moment the vibration reaches its ears, it suddenly gets up and it barks, isn't it? So you should not sleep like a Kumbhakarna. Who is Kumbhakarna? Ravan's brother who sleeps for 6 months and gets up and is awake for 6 months. So should a student be like Kumbhakarna? You should sleep like a dog, very light sleeper. Then Alpaharam. What is Alpaharam? Alpam is small, less, quantity wise very less. Aharam is food. That means, it doesn't mean you have to go always on a starvation mode. No. It means you should not indulge yourself in eating a lot, feasting yourself a lot. And then, have you heard of Kuchailan? Who is Kuchailan? Friend, okay. So it's closely related to that is Jirna Vastram. What is Jirna Vastram? What is Vastram? Clothes. Clothes or dress. Okay. And what is Jirnam? What is Jirnam? What dress? Orange? No. Jirnam is not Ornam. Simple? No. The word, meaning of the word Jirnam. Jirnam is tattered and decayed clothes. That does not mean you have to go wearing torn clothes. Of course, that's a new fashion, isn't it? In your jeans, you have a lot of tears. That has become the fashion. But Jirna Vastra means you should not be overindulgent in a lot of stylish clothes because your focus will go away from that. Understood? So, simple dress. And there's also one more feature, and that is Bhagat Dhyanam. What is Bhagam? Bhagat Dhyanam is, Dhyanam is what? Meditation. Very good, meditation. Bhagam is stork, you know the bird. Have you seen that bird standing on one foot? Yeah. And it will be sleeping. You feel it is sleeping, but actually it is meditating. It is thinking as to which is the next fish that is going to come to the pond and how quickly and how agilely can I take that fish. So a person has to concentrate, has to meditate. Should not indulge, overindulge in food, feasting or clothes. Should get up early in the morning and should be very alert. So these are some of the qualities of a student. And so with these, now I want all of you to have certain things in mind. And the first thing is to have a dream, a big dream, a goal in your life. Now, what is the difference between a goal and a dream? Are they both the same?
No.
Yes, what is goal?
Goal is something you want to achieve.
Yes. Dream is something which you see, your vision, goal is something which you want to achieve. So are they closely related?
Yeah.
No?
Goal is small, dreams, big, dreams are big.
Dreams are big and goals are small?
No.
Then? Yes.
Dream are the visions we see, what we want to be.
Yeah.
And then goal is the vision which we work forward to.
Yes, you are coming close to the point. Yes?
Goals you have to.
And dreams?
Visualize
it. Yeah, good. Any other? Yes.
A dream is the one big thing that you want to achieve in your life, and goals are in progress or the achievements in that particular dream.
Yeah, you all said bits and pieces. Actually, dream is something which you, it's a huge vision, you know. And goals, you have to convert your dreams into goals by setting definite aims and setting timelines and milestones. For instance, you want to become a district collector, okay? In how many years' time? Say, let's say 10 years' time. If you dream and keep dreaming and dreaming, that will remain a daydream. It will not be transformed into your life goal. Now, to achieve that life goal or to make that dream become a goal, you have to convert it into achievable or quantifiable milestones. Okay, in another 3 years, I will finish high school. In another 2 years, I'll finish my secondary school. In another 5 years, I'll finish my professional college, whatever it is, engineering or whatever it be. And then another 2 years, I'll prepare for my IAS and I'll get into the IAS. Another 5, 6, 7 years, I'll be working and I'll become the district collector. So you have milestones about the dream.